rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. resurrection song. This is my hallelujah gong. This is why it's to you I run. There's no place that His love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am.
Turn around and greet your neighbor this morning.
They're excited, overjoyed, and you can see it on their face, you can see it on their eyes.
Some of them are receiving the gifts for the very first time.
It's a symbol to know that God knows me and God loves me.
Jesus loves you.
Before handing out the boxes, we share the gospel with them. Through this shoebox, we want to tell a child that God loves you and He has created you.
We've been able to touch the lives of children all over the world, to give them a gift and do it in Jesus' name.
OCC is making a difference by bringing this joy, but also giving them the true gift, which is Jesus.
It's changing the globe.
Volunteers from all walks of life and all ages love packing Operation Christmas Child Shoebox gifts.
Good job.
Operation Christmas Child is seriously one of the best things going on in the world right now.
Operation Christmas Child is carried on the backs of volunteers. They are incredible people. They just love doing it.
It's humbling to know that you're taking part in spreading the word of God to children that you've never even met. You're showing them the love of Christ.
There's going to be a lot of happiness, and I'm glad I'm a part of it.
When we pray, God takes your gift and He begins to navigate it. Your gifts are then given to children around the world, and that's only the beginning.
After a child receives a shoebox, they are invited to a follow-up discipleship program.
The Greatest Journey is a 12-lesson program where the child gets an opportunity to learn more about Jesus.
It provides a summary of the gospel message in a way that a child will be able to engage and understand.
Through the Greatest Journey, children are growing now knowing the Lord.
When you give a gift and you give it in Jesus' name, God takes that and multiplies it.
Every shoebox is really the beginning of the journey of evangelism and discipleship, and that leads into multiplication.
Through a very small thing, God is touching the world.
From the shoebox to the Greatest Journey, this is the Great Commission.
A shoebox puts a smile on the face of a kid anywhere in the world.
For the rest of their lives, they remember that box.
Isn't it incredible to see the impact that these simple gifts are making in the lives of children all over the world? Millions of children are being blessed not only by the items in each box, but by your prayers. So thank you. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. We never have enough boxes. We always need more. So please continue to help and continue to pray. God bless you and thank you.
Well, good morning. I'm just here to remind you that we're going to participate in Operation Christmas Child again this year. And as you can see from the video, it's just a wonderful ministry that really makes a difference in the lives of those children. Our youth group is having their annual shoebox packing party on November the 14th, so Wednesday night during their normal youth group time. And that's when all the donations are due by. And the youth would love, love, love to have you bring donations for them to pack. They kind of do an assembly line type deal where they grab a box and then get a toy and some school supplies and some hygiene items. And I would encourage you to buy multiples of things, like multiples of pencils would be great, or multiples of stuffed animals. You know, don't just buy one, buy three or buy 10. Just that will really, really help in helping the youth to get their shoeboxes packed. Now, if you as an individual or a family or maybe like your 4-H group or your office people at work would like to go together and do a box or several boxes, you can also do that. Thank you. You can do a theme. That's an idea that I'd seen. You absolutely do not have to do a theme if you don't want to, but I thought it would be fun to try to do one all in pink. So this box, the theme is just everything pink, a pink box, a pink water bottle, pink ruler, pink toothbrush, pink washcloth, a doll with dressed in pink, and pink notebook, and lot, you know, you get the idea. And you could do a theme of animals or sports or cars or just whatever idea you would like, just whatever you think a child would like. But just these, if you pack boxes individually or with a group, these are also due on that Wednesday night, November 14th. And we will get them, we'll collect them all that night and take them to the collection center. So if you have any questions, please ask me. I guess I want to say one more thing. Donations are always welcome too. The shipping is $9 per box, and you can write a check to Faith and give it to either myself or Mike McCartney, and we will get them to Samaritan's Purse to help cover the shipping. And that's always a way that if you don't have time to go shopping, that you can participate. I just want to thank everybody for their help. And again, if you have any questions, let me know. The brochures that tell more about this are on the missions table in the back. And there's also a big Rubbermaid container that says Operation Christmas Child underneath the missions table. And you can start bringing your donations as soon as you would like and put them under the table. And we'll get those down to the youth or get those to the collection center. So thanks again.
Thad, you did an outstanding job. Is it true that it was your idea for the all pink box? That being said, I don't think we're allowed to do camouflage or else that would be a more of a Thad thing. I'd invite our men to come forward to take our morning offering. And even as they do that, I do want to remind most of you that our offering is, we take up the offering because we want to honor the Lord with our finances. If you are just a visitor with us this morning, please feel no obligation to give. This is for those of us who know the Lord, who want to worship Him in this body in this way. So I'd ask that you join with me in a word of prayer. God, our Father, I come before you right now, thanking you again for the opportunity that we have to be here together. God, I'm thankful that we can worship you, that we have the freedoms to do so. I'm thankful that you have given us so many resources, and this is yet one opportunity to give back to you. God, I'm thankful that you are at work in our lives and at work in our church. God, I'm thankful that you're at work in our world as well, drawing people unto yourself. And God, I pray that we would do what we are supposed to do. I pray that we'd be faithful in all of our ministries. And God, right now, we're again just thankful for your grace and for your mercy. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
To victory unto victory. This morning, I want to begin by saying this right off the bat before we get any further. I want you to know that we will all face giants in our lives at some point. They're going to come with many different forms and with many different faces. There might be people in your life who seem to have it out for you. Might be circumstances in your life that just seem to be piling up and getting overwhelming for you. Maybe for you it's going to be a temptation, some form of temptation that seems to be just assailing you and you can't seem to get beyond it. I want you to know that whatever it is right now, whatever that giant, whatever that struggle, whatever that obstacle that you are facing, I want you to know that our passage today teaches us on how to begin to overcome these struggles, obstacles, giants in our lives. We know that all Christians have battles to fight. All Christians will face enemies and obstacles that need to be overcome. And of course, our story today regarding David and Goliath, it gives us some great lessons. Some great lessons for us to grab onto, some things that we can learn and hear and understand and then begin moving forward in our lives. The story of David and Goliath is so rich and it's so big, and I'm going to take 2 weeks to talk through the entirety of this story. It all is found in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17, and there's well over 50 verses that deal with this story. But what I'm going to do today is just preach part one. Just part one, which is going to be everything leading up to that great battle scene. And so we'll get there in just a minute. Maybe as you're turning to find the book of 1 Samuel, just a couple things that I want to point out regarding our main thought for this morning. And it comes not even in the form of my thought for you, but it's more of the question for this morning. Question for you to ask yourselves, and then a question for you to ask of the text that we'll be reading this morning. And this main question is simply this: how can we be victorious? How do we find victory over the enemies of our souls? How do we find victory against all of our struggles and all of the situations that seem to come against us? Where are our eyes fixed during those moments of difficulties? How can we win? It's a whole bunch of different ways to say our main question is this: how can we be victorious? And that's something that I think each one of us needs to process, because God doesn't want us just to wallow in self-pity. God does not want us to live in defeat. God does not want us to live in different forms of discouragement or despair. God wants us to live victoriously. And what do I mean by that? A victorious Christian life is a life that is lived by faith, and it is lived with our eyes firmly fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. So what I believe our passage teaches us today is I believe it teaches us how we can find victory. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to go through this story. I want to read the scripture. I want to talk through the story, and I want to tell you a couple things that we can learn from this. So if you're not already there, I'd invite you to turn your Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. And I'm just going to read the first 39 verses for you this morning. I would assume, I guess I can't guarantee anything, but I'm assuming most of you will know how the story ends. So it's not like I'm going to leave you on a cliffhanger if I only read these 39 verses. But I would encourage you to follow along, because it is a rather lengthy passage. But I want you to get the flavor, and I want you to get the feel of what is going on in the life of David, in the life of Saul, in the life of Goliath, and in the life of God as well. I just want you to soak it up and let your eyes follow along in scriptures. Maybe you see this passage in a new light this morning. I think there's such value in doing this because we could all tell stories that we think we know about David and Goliath, but maybe we don't know the whole story until we sit back and read. So 1 Samuel chapter 17, I'm going to begin reading in verse 1. It says, "Now the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle, and they were gathered at Succah, which belongs to Judah, and they encamped between Succah and Azekah in Ephes-Damim. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together, and they encamped in the valley of Elah, and they drew up in battle array against the Philistines." Now verse 3 says, "The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on the mountain on the other side, and there was a valley between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span." By the way, that is either 9 feet 9 inches or 9 feet 6 inches, depending on which version or which text you read. But we're talking a guy who's almost 10 feet tall right here. Verse 5, "He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze." Now you might be saying, "Wow, 5,000 shekels of bronze, how big is that?" It's about 125 to 150 pounds of armor this guy is wearing right here. Verse 6, "He had bronze armor on his legs and a bronze javelin between his shoulders. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels, and a shield bearer went before him." Verse 8, "And he stood and he cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, 'Why have you come up to line up in battle? Am I not a Philistine and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourself and let him come down to me. And if he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us.' And the Philistine said, 'I defy the armies of Israel on this day. Give me a man that we may fight together.' And when Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistines, Saul went out to fight him." Wait, no, it doesn't say that, does it? When Saul and all of Israel heard the words of the Philistine, what did they do? Did they go out to battle? Did they say, "You know what? We can't do it on our own, but with God's power, we can take this guy out"? They didn't say that either. It says this, "When they heard the words of Goliath, they were dismayed and they were greatly afraid." Verse 12, "Now David was the son of the Ephrathite of Bethlehem of Judah, whose name was Jesse, who had 8 sons, and the man was old, advanced in years, in the days of Saul. And the 3 oldest sons of Jesse had gone to follow Saul to the battle. The names of these 3 sons who went to battle were Eliab, the firstborn, next to him Abinadab, and the 3rd, Shammah." Now, all 3 of these guys are talked about in chapter 16. And we looked at that last week, and we talked about what God is looking for in a man. And he's not looking for the military strength or the height or the good-looking guys. He's looking for someone who is faithful. So you got these 3 oldest sons. They're off in battle with Saul, but not David. Verse 14. It says, "And David was the youngest, and the 3 oldest had followed Saul. But David occasionally went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem." Let me pause here just for a moment because we didn't talk about this last week. But in 1 Samuel chapter 16, we discover that there is an evil spirit that comes upon Saul from time to time. The thing that would sort of chase away the spirit or his feelings of discouragement was when David would come and play the harp before him. And so David kind of shifts ground from Bethlehem, where he's taking care of the sheep, and he would go frequently to the palace, where he was a court musician for Saul. And so what we see here in chapter 17 is it tells us that usually David is in the palace doing what he's supposed to be doing, but here we discover that he goes back occasionally to the sheepfold. So verse 15, David occasionally went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem. And the Philistine drew near, in verse 16, and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. Then Jesse said to his son David, "Take now for your brothers an ephah of dried grain and 10 loaves, and run to your brothers at the camp, and carry these 10 cheeses to the captain of their 1,000, and see how your brothers fare, and bring back news." So Jesse is sending a son, saying, "Go and take this to your older brothers. They're up fighting the battle. Go and do this, and then report back to me and tell me everything that is going on right there." Verse 19, "Now Saul and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines." Now really, of course, we learn that they weren't really fighting. They were standing on opposite sides of a valley, kind of hurling insults back and forth, and that was it. Verse 20, "So David arose early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper, and he took the things and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the camp as the army was going out to fight, and shouting for battle. For Israel and the Philistines had drawn up in battle array, army against army." But again, I want to remind you that this is all posture. The Israelites didn't really go and fight against the Philistines here. They would kind of dress up in all their battle array. They'd put on their army. They would kind of do all of these military-ish looking things. And they would come forward a little bit, and then they would stand there, and they wouldn't actually fight right there. Verse 22, "And David left his supplies in the hand of a supply keeper, and he ran to the army, and he came and he greeted his brothers." Verse 23, "Then as he talked with them, there was the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name. And he was coming up from the armies of the Philistines, and he spoke according to the same words, and so David heard them." This is the first time that David had heard these taunts that came from Goliath. Verse 24, "And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, they fled from him, and they were dreadfully afraid. And so the men of Israel said, 'Have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel, and it shall be that the man who kills him, the king will enrich with great riches and give him his daughter and give his father's house exemption from taxes in Israel.'" What we have right here in verse 25 is this is evidence of sort of the cowardice of the king. You've got King Saul, who should be out there fighting a battle, but instead what Saul is doing is taking a step back and saying, "You know what? This guy's big. I really don't want to fight him. But I'll tell you what I'll do. I will bribe someone to go and fight. Hey, if you win this battle, you get to marry my daughter. Plus, there's going to be no taxes. Plus, there's going to be riches that you can't even imagine." He's trying to induce his guys to step up and do something, even when he is not willing to do something. Verse 26. "Then David spoke to the men who stood by him and said, 'What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away this reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?'" I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but I just want to point this out right here. David sees things from a different perspective than the other Israelites, or than King Saul, or than any of the other Philistines see. What David sees is he doesn't see this guy who is defying the armies of Israel. He doesn't just look and see this guy who's saying, Israel, you guys are a bunch of losers and I'm going to kill you. Instead, what he does is he sees this man who is defying God. In David's mind, Goliath wasn't just standing up and saying, down to Israel. Goliath is standing up and saying, your God is worthless. Your God can never help. Your God can't do anything. And to David, he's saying, whoa, this guy isn't just talking bad about our nation. This guy is maligning and blaspheming our God. And so this, David sees from a different perspective. No one else saw it this way. David sees the spiritual, not just the physical. We'll talk more about that next week. Verse 27. The people answered him in this matter, saying, so shall it be done for the man who kills him. Verse 28. Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David. And he said, why did you come down here, and with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle. And David said, what have I done now? Is there not a cause? And then he turned from him toward another and said the same thing. And these people answered as the first ones did. Now when the words, I'm on verse 31, by the way, and I know this is taking a long time. There's so many good things that are found here. Verse 31, and when the words which David spoke were heard, they reported them to Saul, and he sent for him. And then David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. By the way, we do believe David is probably about 17 years of age right here. He might be as young as 15, but just to kind of clear it up, David's not like this 10-year-old boy who's fighting against this giant. So David is a man who is already growing into some form of wisdom, although there's little doubt that he is a teenager at this time. Saul said to David, verse 33, you are not able to go up against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth, and he is a man of war since his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or bear came and took a lamb from out of the flock, I went after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard, and I struck and killed it. Verse 36, your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing as he has defied the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord, who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. So Saul clothed David with his armor, and he put a bronze helmet on his head, and he also clothed him with a coat of mail. And David fastened on his sword to his armor, and he tried to walk, for he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these. I cannot walk with these, for I have not tested them. And so David took them off. Next week, verse 40 and following, for the stunning conclusion. I want to give you three disclaimers to start out with. I want us to see this story accurately. And so I want you to know what is not going on right here. Because again, sometimes we hear and we think we know what's going on, and it might not be entirely accurate. So first thing, I want you to know that this story of David and Goliath, in fact, I don't even want to call it a story, this narrative, this true account of David and Goliath, it is not an underdog story. It's not an underdog story. All of us have heard situations described as, wow, that's a real David and Goliath story, as in this person is such an underdog and he's able to defeat someone else. This is not an underdog story. In fact, what we are going to discover, and this brings us to our second point already, is this. It is not even a human confrontation. Obviously, yes, David does go into battle against Goliath, and we'll see that more next week. Obviously, we all know that that happens, but in reality, this is a spiritual conflict. This is not David versus Goliath. What this is right here is God versus Goliath. We've got this giant of a man who comes on the scene, and he is openly ridiculing the God of Israel. David looks to the Lord, but it is God then who sends this young man, this youth named David, to go up and to do battle. As we read the story, we begin to understand that we serve a God who is able to take care of situations that appear to be hopeless. Let me repeat that. We serve or we follow after a God who takes care of hopeless situations. He takes care of us in those times when we seem to be overwhelmed. And so ultimately, it's not an underdog story about David. It's not about human confrontation at all. In one sense, and here's where we get to our third disclaimer, in one sense, the hero of this story is not even David. And yes, I know our whole series is on David and from shepherd to king, etc., etc., but the hero is not David. I mean, if anything, maybe you could count him a hero because he's a man of faith, but the hero in this story is God. And yeah, David went and he grabbed these stones and he put them in a sling and whipped it around and threw that stone. But in reality, the weapon that David used, entirely irrelevant. It didn't matter. He could have taken a stick and thrown it, and God would have directed that to kill Goliath. David is not the hero. God is the hero in this story. So those are the three quick disclaimers, and you can fight me on those later if you want, but I don't believe this is an underdog story. I don't believe it's even about human confrontation. At its deep level, it's a spiritual matter that we're talking about right here. So let's talk through this story. I want to point out that this is an important battle for Israel. It's important because Israel at this time was an occupied nation. I shared that with you a couple weeks ago. Israel had been overrun by the Philistines. The Philistines were far more advanced in all their ironwork and their armor and their shields and their swords and everything, far more advanced, and they invaded Israel. And basically, Israel is in servitude before these Philistines. And so this becomes an important battle to fight because the people of God, this Israelite nation who was supposed to follow after God and live for God and obey all of his statutes, these people had begun to fail God. And this is a fight for independence. It's a fight to stand on God and on God's truth and on God's word. So what we've got here is this is an important battle. As I've already shared, this takes place in a valley. It's called the Valley of Elah. And you've got a sloping hillside on either side. And then the middle, there's a dry creek bed that goes through there. And it's probably just couple hundred yards in between the sides, and that's why Goliath is able to stand on his side and shout all sorts of insults, and then the army on the other side could hear everything. Here's a picture in Israel, and this is what they say is the actual side, and you've got the trees over there, and that would be on the north side, actually, and that's where the Israelite army would be, and the hills that are over here on the south side, that would be the area where the Philistines were. And right down in the middle there, there's that dry creek bed. And so you've got this important battle right here for Israel, for God, for their history, and everything else. So you've got an important battle. Second thing is this. We have got a very large man. He is described in detail, 9 feet, 9 inches tall. One of the other texts says 9 feet six, but hey, let's go big here. 9 feet, 9 inches tall. We're told some other things about him. Of course, his name is Goliath of Gath. He's got a lot of armor, and it weighs quite a bit. I got a comparison picture here, not drawn by me. They estimate David's height as a young man. They're guessing like 5'2", maybe 5'6", at the tallest. Shaquille O'Neal, you know, I make mention of this guy occasionally, size 22 shoe. Shaquille O'Neal, 7'1". Goliath was the great big spear, 9'6", or 9'9", depending on which text you read. You got a great big guy. We've got this guy, Goliath, who's 4 feet, over 4 feet taller than David. This is a pretty significant deal right here. And so you've got this very large man, but even bigger than his body is his mouth. This guy is mouthy about the Israelites and ultimately about their God as well. And so he's shouting or hurling insults. And even in verse 8, when he says, "Am I not a Philistine?" he's really saying, "Am I not the Philistine? Am I not the man here that all of you should just look up to and revere and cower in fear over?" We see that just like arrogance is dripping off of this guy right here. And frankly, in light of the size of this guy, you really can't blame the other Israelites, right? I mean, as they looked at themselves and they said, okay, we're a bunch of like guys who are 5'6", maybe 5'8", tops. We really can't fight this guy. You know, maybe they're thinking, you know, I got a wife and a couple kids back home, and I really don't want to go and fight this guy. You can understand where they are coming from with this. And so they are frightened. They've got this great giant of a man right there. And this brings us to our third element of the story, is we've got a fearful king. You've got King Saul, who is fairly cowardly. We've got King Saul, who is standing back. It says that, verse 11 says that Saul and all of Israel were dismayed and greatly afraid. King Saul, to be the leader, to be the one first in battle. King Saul, terrified, greatly afraid, would hear these taunts, and he's kind of hiding back in his tent. And what we're going to see in the study of David is time after time, there's a biblical contrast that is set up between the attitudes and actions and spirituality of Saul versus the attitudes, actions, and devotions of David. So 40 days in a row, morning and night, Goliath is coming out, hurling his insults, defaming the God of Israel, and Saul just cowers in fear. Now, why would he do that? He would do that because Saul is not one who is a faithful man. Saul is not one that had a relationship with God. Saul is one who has lived in disobedience already to God. Saul is not one who trusted in God to deliver him. Saul is everything opposite of what David is. And so we can understand his fear because he didn't have a relationship with God at all at this point in time. So of course he sees it from his human perspective, and of course he sees all of these trials piling up in front, and he's afraid. And here's where I want to turn this back on you as well, and we're going to continue to develop this next week as well. But I want you to think about whatever the issue that you're facing, whatever it is in your life that might seem insurmountable to you, whatever it is that seems to be piling up. Maybe it's that thing that kind of keeps you awake at night. Maybe it's something that every time you think of it, you kind of have that pang in your heart or in your life. Or maybe it's that temptation that seems to beat you every single time. Whatever it is, I guarantee you have got some sort of giant in your life, something that is causing you some sort of fear or some apprehension or maybe some sort of sin in your life. What I need you to do is not to look at that situation from a human perspective, but I want to challenge you to see that situation through God's eyes. Don't look at it like Saul would look at it. Instead, I want to challenge you to look at that situation how David would do it. Look at it from the God looking down perspective. Look at it not from the perspective of fear, but look at it from the perspective of faith. And so what we see in these next verses is we see David. We see this man who is a faithful man. He hears the taunts of Goliath and he says, hold on, we got to do something about this guy. Here he is maligning and blaspheming against our God. We've got to do something. Obviously, David in the flesh, David in all of his humanity, obviously he is no match for Goliath. He can't do a thing on his own, but what we do see is that he serves the living God. Verse 26 says, this guy is defying the armies of the living God. David takes offense on behalf of God. He is able to see it clearly. This makes all the difference in the world. The other soldiers and Saul are looking on and they're saying, yeah, but do you see this guy? Do you see how big he is? And David is saying essentially, yeah, I see, but it doesn't matter because our God is bigger. Of course, he didn't say those exact words, but that's the concept that we see. And we're going to see it next week as well. As David looked on, yeah, he saw Goliath. How could he not see Goliath? Goliath is filling his whole field of vision. He saw Goliath, but most importantly, he saw God. I want you to grab hold of that. Yes, he saw the problem. Yes, he saw the giant. But bigger than that, he saw God. Whatever your struggle, whatever your giant, cement this in your mind. God is bigger. He's bigger than your situation right there. He's bigger than all of the things that assail you or that bother you, that hurt you, that cause you fear. God is bigger than all of those things. Quick word about giants in our lives. Very quickly, they loom large. Okay, the giants in our lives, the struggles, the issues, they're big. I'm not going to try to minimize this. They are real. They're not just these figments of the imagination. The giants in your life, your struggles, maybe it's health or loss of job or interpersonal relationships, whatever it is, it looms large in your life. I'm not trying to pass that aside. I'm not trying to dismiss that. They loom large from you. Your struggles are probably going to occur daily. That's our second point. Not just that they're big, but it's going to keep on coming at you again and again and again. And the third word about our giants is they often paralyze us. Our giants that come into our lives paralyze us sometimes to inactivity. And so what do we need to do? I just have one closing thought right here. My closing thought is this: God is the only one who can grant you spiritual victory in the struggles in your life. God is the only one who can do that. We've all got struggles. I think it would be very profitable for all of you this morning, before you pack up and get ready to go and everything else, I think it would be very profitable this morning to think just for a minute and identify one. I want to challenge you right now, think for a minute, identify at least one struggle that you're facing. Identify at least one giant in your life that seems to weigh on your mind or keep you up all night or give you some sort of apprehension in life. Identify one of those. Maybe it's the sin issue that seems to just get you every single time and take you down. I want you to think about what that is. Identify it in your mind, and then what we need to do is take that to the Lord in prayer. And we go before God and we say, God, you know what? I can't do it on my own. I can't battle this temptation. I can't work through this situation. I can't overcome this obstacle on my own. God, I need you to take care of it. And then you go back to God 5 minutes later and you do that same prayer. And then this is one of those 100 times a day, a prayer every time you give that over to God again and again and again. Now, I don't have all of the answers for you right here, but what I do have is I know that God is the one who gives the strength. And I want you to remember this. God is God, okay? God is God. Giants are not God. Who do you want on your side to do battle? Who is the only one who can give you victory? And it's our God in heaven. I want to close here, but as I do so, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me, and then I want you to take just 10 seconds, 15 seconds before I actually pray, and I just want you to bring that before God in the quietness of your own heart and in your own mind. You don't need to say anything out loud, but I want to give you just that time of silence for you to bring that item, that giant, that struggle, bring that up before God and just say, God, help me with this. And do that in the quietness of your own head, and after about 10 or more seconds, I will close this in a word of prayer. Let's go to the Lord right now. Father God, I come before you right now, once again thanking you that we have been able to read about your truth in the scripture. We're thankful as we look at the life of David that you do give him victory. You allow him to see things from that spiritual perspective. God, I know that we all face different things in our lives. And God, even as I've encouraged our people to think about and identify and pray through their circumstance, God, I pray that you would also give them the victory that they so desperately need. Father, I think about that especially in times of doubt or in times of serious sin issues. God, we know that you want us to be victorious. And right now I pray that we would overcome these things that seem to bombard or assail us. And God, I pray that we would find that victory, not because of our own wisdom or our own strength, but we'd find that victory because of you, and that you would be the one who provides everything that we need and the deliverance that we need as well. And so, God, we come before you this morning just asking these things, and God, I do ask your blessing upon your people this morning. I pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please join us in the other room for coffee and cookies, and then Sunday school to follow.